Next one.
All right. Okay.
All right. Thank you all, and welcome to the Barbershop. My name is Terry T. Holla.
Hollimon.
And I am Marcus Trufant. The one and only.
True. We did this last week. You're true. In the Barbershop, we don't use government names, right?
So I want everybody to know who I am, T, so I'm gonna give them the real deal. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, all right, right. Well, thank you all for being here with us tonight.
Mm-hmm.
In the Barbershop, we are the voice of the people, the voice inside the locker room. We have the conversations that you're not gonna get anywhere else. You can't get anywhere else, but only in the Barbershop.
Yes, it's only in the Barbershop, and the barbershops that I grew up going to, the different type of barbershops. You not only can get a haircut, you can find lawyer advice, you can find wedding advice, you could buy CDs, you could buy food, you could do it all. So that's the flavor we gonna bring. It's a different type of barbershop. It's everything you need.
Yes, everything you need all in one. I went last week, I got a copy of Jurassic Park 3D.
The new one, of course.
The new one, before
the one
it
that's
came
still
out.
Still in theater, still in theater.
Still in the theaters. I got it at the barbershop with the glasses. So,
all right.
So yeah, like we do things outside the box. And like earlier, we were on the radio. We decided to bring it to you guys live here at B47 to get out here and give you guys the firsthand experience. And you know, Marcus and I are old football players.
Not too old, T. Don't put that on me. I'm still a young man. So you know, I can still run around a little bit.
Yeah. You're a little younger than me. But people think we talk about is football. And you know, we're gonna talk about football because we live in Seattle. We got a pretty good football team here. I don't know if you guys heard about it.
Yeah.
Seattle Seahawks, so yes, we will talk about football. Before we go too far, we have a football player in the audience here with us tonight, a special guest.
Yes.
Josh Brown.
Give it up for Josh Brown.
He's to play for the Seahawks. He's now kicking for the New York Giants. Yeah. But we don't just talk football here. We do all sports. We talk about football, basketball.
Baseball. It's a little bit of baseball.
Football. And then some more basketball. But we do it all. And you know, matter of fact, this weekend we had a very eventful weekend as far as sports go, right?
Yeah, we did a little bit of everything this weekend. We did the Jamal Crawford Pro-Am tournament. We were there. We messed around there because, you know, we love our basketball. And I have a foundation. Terry was part of it. He emceed the Trufant Family Foundation Beach Volleyball event. That was great. So that's beach volleyball for two black dudes out in Washington. Great event. I had a lot of fun. But yeah, so we do it all.
Yeah, we do. As a matter of fact, we got some video of us out this weekend on all the things we were doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
had a lot of fun in the barbershop.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So again, a sport that you would normally not put you and I in,
exactly.
Volleyball. We went out there and had a lot of fun with it. We also did, as he mentioned, the Jamal Crawford Pro-Am. And again, that was for charity. Jamal Crawford is a Seattle guy. He brings all the professional basketball players here to Seattle since we don't have a basketball team here anymore. And he bring you that boo, right?
Come on. It was a great event, though. Great event. All the local ballers, even guys from all the way around the league, had Isaiah Thomas, Jamal Crawford, had Sean Kemp and Gary Payton were the coaches.
All right.
Slick Watts and
Lenny Wilkins.
And Lenny Wilkins were the coaches on the other side. So it was a good event. And the barbershop was in the building, of course. So it was all around good event.
Yeah, and we also have some footage of that, too. Let's see us at the basketball event this week.
Barbershop heavy. Got me to sweat.
Terry's nervous face. We got a thing coming up soon. I don't think Terry want to do it, but it's going to be fun, man. Barbershop, baby, getting ready for the halftime game.
I ain't gonna make it. My ass too big. Go!
Look at that guy! Woo! See how it's the first time we've been in the house.
Oh, everybody give it up for T. Holla.
Yes.
I caught the end of that. Did anybody catch that celebration that T. Holla did, though? Can we run that back in slow motion? Can we get that? All right, does anybody know what that is? That is the Marshawn Lynch pinch.
I had to do it, man.
So do we need to fine T. Holla, or what do we need to do? Because Marshawn, did he get fined for that?
He got fined. I'm not getting fined. The commissioner didn't see that, man.
He's still in celebrations. But
I got away with that one.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, that's just an example of what the Barbershop is all about. We do everything, man. We have fun, and it's across all sports. Mm-hmm. And just to prove that, we got a special guest with us tonight. That is not a sport that we're normally familiar with.
But yes.
We're learning though, right?
We are learning on the fly.
We're learning. And we are very privileged to have a guy who's a recent inductee into the United States Soccer Hall of Fame.
Yep. He was captain of the Seattle Sounders.
Yes. And he was actually named the U.S. Soccer Player of the Year 3 times. So let's just look at a little video real quick.
Goal. Giggs. Look at that ball through! Shot saved by Keller!
And just pawed away there by Keller. And it's denied by Keller!
An excellent save by Keller. And it's a save from Keller! What a save!
Saved by Kasey Keller!
An excellent save by Keller! What a save!
Kasey Keller!
Keller!
And it's a save from Keller!
Saved by Kasey Keller!
Saved by Keller!
They come into the Sounders half. It's a poor back pass. Kari Stevens, who threw on goal. Kasey Keller, magnificent. Chris Wondolowski. Keller's going to get back in his goal. Wondolowski saved again by Kasey Keller. Still not cleared. Simon Dawkins. Drive comes in. Keller again for a third time. And he smothers the danger again. This is absolutely astonishing. You will not see better goalkeeping anywhere in the world. 4 saves in the same movement.
That's right. You'll never.
All right.
Help us welcome to the stage the great Kasey Keller.
Yeah. Welcome, 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 welcome. Yeah, go ahead, take a seat,
nice,
brother.
Have a seat, man. Make yourself at home.
Yes, yes, yes.
Kasey.
You say you don't know a sport. I mean, I actually played football.
Well,
you guys played American football.
Well, we won't.
I played football.
We won't get into that just yet, because I know that could turn into a little bit of a discussion
on the
stage.
A fight. A fight.
It's the Barbershop. We're keeping it real. A fight. Thank you for joining us here tonight.
Pleasure.
The people want to know. I want to know. What have you been doing since you stopped letting people kick balls at your face?
Everything I wasn't allowed to do when I was playing. So as you know, as a player, and as you've seen some of these NFL guys who decided to blow their hands off with fireworks, you can't.
Shots.
There's certain things you're not supposed to do as a professional athlete. And so for me now, it's making up for lost time. I'm motorcycles, wakeboarding, snowboarding, everything I could do that could hurt myself that I wasn't allowed to do while I was playing. So my wife didn't say, how come we're not making any money anymore? So those little things that you just... And then just broadcasting. I mean, that was, for me, the transition into broadcasting couldn't have been probably smoother. So to go from a 20-year career to pretty much have a couple weeks off, or not a couple, maybe a couple months off, and then work my way straight into that side of it and do all the Sounders games, which was nice to stay local and stay, you know, relevant on that side and keep supporting the sport and keep pushing it forward. And then, you know, have the contract with ESPN and then be able to stay relevant on the national side as well and be involved. You know, I was in Brazil for 42 days for the World Cup and did, I think, 13 games and a bunch of studio stuff. So it was a lot of fun.
Cool, cool. So moving from playing professional soccer for all the years that you played and moving straight into broadcasting, was that kind of a natural or easy transition for you?
I think it is if it feels natural to you. I think we've all seen athletes who don't feel as comfortable on the camera, or just anybody in general who doesn't feel comfortable in front of the camera and able to articulate themselves in a particular way. And I did a lot of media work in England when I was playing. And imagine that the NBA, the NFL, and Major League Baseball are one sport. Now you've got the Premier League in England. And so think of the programming and everything that they're showing is, and so they're always wanting athletes to come on and be a part of shows. And when they realize that you can complete a sentence, then they ask you a lot to come on and do things.
You were able to complete
sentences. I was able to complete sentences. And so when you, you know, then you have to find that balance, because you will be asked nonstop once they realize that you're comfortable in front of the camera. But then you have to understand what's your job and focus on what you're doing and make sure you're not doing too much media work and not focusing on the job in hand and trying to stop people from scoring goals. And the hard part is, and there's not really a worse position, I think, in any sport in the world than being a goalkeeper. So
really? Yeah. I mean, why?
You're back there by yourself. Everybody sees you. And when you make a mistake, you are completely punished. There's some similarities to being a defensive back.
I was just going to say that. I know some guys.
You know some guys that have been through this stuff. Where there is that focus, and that you know, yeah, of course, there's times a great pass, great catch, you had it defended well. But more often than not, when you get beat for a touchdown, someone's going, "Oh, was that guy?" And then same thing, you know.
That's people, you should have done better.
And when, you know, people were asking me, you know, were you nervous doing games, going into broadcasting and stuff? I said, well, I mean, if I mess up a name, it's completely different than letting a ball go through my legs and for a goal. So the pressure on that side of it was completely different. And so I was very happy after. And you know, people would ask me all the time, "Do you miss playing?" I'm like, not one day. What I did feel weird about was I felt weird seeing somebody else in my position. Mm-hmm. So that first game, I'm broadcasting the game for the Sounders, and I'm sitting up there, and Michael Sperling had gone in goal, but it wasn't like I wanted to be there. It just felt weird. I just didn't want anybody else
to be
there.
You wanted your spot.
Yeah. So
you're greedy.
Well, I think
Kasey Keller is greedy.
I'm greedy. But it was just one of those, it just felt weird seeing somebody else where I was, even though I didn't want to be there anymore myself.
Right. Well, you talked about some of the similarities of playing defensive back and being a goalkeeper. So another similarity that I want to talk about, or kind of ask a question, you have certain guys on the football field, and I know Josh Brown was in the back, but we have certain positions that you make fun of. You know,
sure.
You got your kickers, okay?
Yeah.
They're known to be wimpier guys, Josh.
Different.
Oh, I saw Josh somebody. Different. Josh, like,
different.
Yeah, Josh lit up different. A few yeah. people, though, yeah.
You know, you got your quarterbacks, and that time,
yeah.
they're a little
sure. yeah.
soft.
Overprotected.
Right. So yeah. on the soccer field, what position would that be? And to be honest, before I did my little research. See, yeah. I got my note cards. I thought that might be the goalie. He might be the guy that's nah. not the toughest guy on the team. So explain to me and the other people
who don't know soccer. Here's what you got to think about. You got to think about that I have to put my face places that I really don't want to put my face.
On balls. On balls. So, right.
You got to put your face on balls.
I got to dive at somebody's feet.
Right.
I got to do a bunch of things that, well,
right.
yeah. So yes, there are situations that you don't want to get yourself into. But I think for me, and obviously maybe it's because I was a goalkeeper, but strikers are just whining little babies.
Mm-hmm.
Who they, you know, and they get all the glory and they get all the money, just like, you know, like a wide receiver. I mean, I think we've seen a few wide receivers in their day on their exercise bike in their yard, you know, doing things to get attention.
Right.
And, crunches in the driveway.
Yeah. Exactly.
Shirts off at all times.
Yeah.
Right.
And so I think that's goal scorers, guys who score, usually seem to be a little bit more egocentric than those of us in the back.
Okay. I like it. For all you strikers out there, stop being weenies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's talk about the state of soccer, or as you called it,
football.
Football, yeah. Let's talk about the state of soccer in America.
Okay.
Seattle Sounders have notoriously crazy, outrageous fans. Would you guys agree with me there?
For sure. No question.
But the same cannot be said around the country, you know. I think when you look at the big three sports, basketball, football, baseball, soccer kind of trails behind, and it's kind of it's not gaining the traction that a lot of us think it should get. Why do you think that is, and what do we need to do in order to make it gain more ground?
Well, I think it's in some ways it's gaining tremendous ground. For example, if you look at what ESPN is projecting, and they're saying that the average age of a baseball fan is about 58, and the average fan of a soccer fan is about 25. So the projections are moving very well. You look at the numbers of participation and the numbers of people, not just kids, girls, but across all age levels, playing soccer in America is really far greater than almost any other sport. So the trends are definitely pushing in the right direction. I think there was, you know, situations for myself, for example. So I'm a farm kid from Olympia.
That's right, Olympia.
Local. Local. That sounds. And
support local, yeah.
And my dad was a like a typical kind of American, you know, never had a passport, never traveled out of the country, never kind of in that part of it. So I think he didn't understand when I started giving up the other sports to play soccer. And I just kind of questioned me. So you have these opportunities to do these different things, and what are you know, how are you choosing a sport that doesn't even have a professional league? At that stage, there was no MLS, and why are you, and the NASL had already folded. And I just said, I need to go to Europe and preferably England. But here's the arrogance of youth. So I was probably about 15, 16 when I've pretty much given up all the other sports at that stage. And I'm saying I'm going to go play in England. I was the first American to play on an American passport in England. And here's this, you know, stupid farm kid from Olympia who's 15 saying, yeah, I'm not going to play this sport. I'm not going to play that because I'm going to go be this professional soccer, this American professional soccer player in England. I think, see if I'm wrong, but most professional athletes have to be borderline arrogant. So you have to be confident, because if I didn't have the confidence that I thought I could do something that even today, with a number of us who have gone over and played in Europe, and they said to me, oh, I'm focusing everything I can to go be a professional soccer player in Europe. And I would say, well, good luck with that. But you have to have that dream. You have to fulfill. And I continued this speech, and I was just kind of saying some things as I'm kind of talking about just the confidence and arrogance and direction and drive and motivation, all this kind of stuff. And I said, yeah, I said, so the hard part is you have to have that dream. You have to prepare for failure, but you have to have that dream. But sometimes it doesn't matter. You know, every motivational speaker will tell you, you can do whatever you want to do if you just put your mind to it. And I kind of said, well, actually, no, you can't.
Right. Can. I see potential.
You can.
You I got mean, potential.
Look, I was I was quick. I was a 4'6", 40 guy in high school and could two-hand dunk a basketball as there a sophomore go. And stuff like that. But if my dream was to win the 100 meters at the Olympics, it didn't matter how hard I trained or whatever I did or however, I was never going to attain that goal. And then I continued saying stuff. I said, and the other bad part was I had this absolute horrible fear of needles. And there went my dream of winning the Tour de France.
Only in the barbershop.
So I mean, I think what it is, as a kid, you kind of figure out what you're good at, what you think is your passion, and you drive towards that. And I was just fortunate that I was able to be one of the first Americans to kind of break into the scene over in Europe and kind of get things started for what has been I think, a tremendous step forward for American soccer in a very short period of time. I mean, I played for teams that were founded in the 1880s.
Right.
Wow.
So you think of, you know, the Sounders, MLS Sounders being 2009 and the earliest Sounders in 74. I mean, there's teams that were 100 years old by that stage. Mm-hmm. So think of what the NFL was in the 20s or in the 60s or in the 80s.
Right.
You know, it's a huge progression. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. And MLS has made some great strides in 20 years. They have a long ways to go to catch up. And I think the other thing in to your point was there's so much competition in America for the viewer, for the athlete, for the fan. Where, I mean, I remember interviews. It might be, if I'm remembering correctly, but when I was playing in Spain, you know, Sergio Garcia making a point that he would have given up every golf title he ever had to play 5 minutes for Real Madrid.
Ooh.
And so you
it's
have,
a different world. Over
it
there.
Is.
It's a whole entirely different world in Europe.
Completely. Okay. Completely. And it's and it's any kind of show, any kind of call-in, radio, everything is 99% soccer and 5% or 1% everything else.
Yeah, that's crazy. So,
that's you.
Well, I guess to piggyback off that, you know, with soccer and the way that's going, you said it's on a steady incline, but the women's side of soccer at the professional level and the differences of pay and different stuff like that, do you think that that's going to catch up, or how do you think that's going to work?
Everything is TV-driven and fan-driven. If, as you know, I mean, I remember talking to one of your old bosses, Todd Lightwicky, a long time ago about CBA contract negotiations.
Right.
It's peaks and valleys. When the owners are making a ton of money, the players are in a little bit of a control and they're fine. They're saying, look, we are earning you all that money. Therefore, we need to take our share. Then the players take so much of a share that the owners aren't making enough money. And then the owners are then fighting and have the power over the players saying, look, it's our money on the line. We're not making enough of it to make work. So then they take some off the players. So really what it comes down to is when you're making money and people are watching you and people are coming to the stadium, then your demand for salaries will increase because you can't be paid if you're not making any money to
Makes
be
sense.
Paid.
Makes
and
sense.
So when the sponsorship dollars there and the fans watch and the and it's the same thing with MLS. And right now the TV, I want to say, MLS might have surpassed the NBA on attendance at the stadiums, but the TV revenue is light years apart because of the amount of people who are watching it on TV. And you look at what the English Premier League is being watched all around the world and why their TV, you know, I made a mistake in England. I had 120 million people around the world know that I made a mistake in England, you know, because it's so huge in all these other countries all around the world. So those are that's what's going to drive any kind of salary is always attendance first, television, but television is the real key.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of the women's soccer, a fellow goalie who plays women's soccer, Hope Solo, she's probably the best goalie. I'm still learning, y'all. Goalie in women's soccer, but do you think some of her off the field stuff that she has going on will affect her legacy and being one of the best in the game?
Is it going to affect Ray Rice?
Interesting question because it could, but it might not because a lot of the stuff gets swept under the rug.
Sure.
After a while, you know, time and
well, of course, and I'm a huge proponent for second chances. I'm not a huge proponent for third chances. So I think everybody makes mistakes and everybody does things, you know, and to a point. But we also are role models. We also, if you want to or not, I mean, you know, Charles Barkley said, I'm not a role model. And you need to treat it accordingly. And you need to understand that people are watching.
Right.
And I was talking to my bosses at ESPN one time and I kind of said to him, I said, look, you know, some of it's kind of your fault. And I said, what do you mean? I said, how often are you seeing the guys doing things the right way on SportsCenter? And how often are you seeing the people doing things the wrong way on SportsCenter?
Very good point.
And so you're teaching a whole new generation of athletes If you want to be on SportsCenter, you have to be a jackass.
Basically.
Not do things the right way.
And we
know the agents that are saying to their clients, go do something stupid, because that's going to make a name for you quicker than doing things the right
way.
Get
a reality TV show if you go out and do something crazy.
And unfortunately, it's here to stay. But I think most sports fans understand the difference between the athlete and the person. And people would ask me, you know, before I was an athlete and before I kind of knew different players, who were your heroes growing up? Well, I said, once I became an athlete and I knew some of these guys off the field, I said, well, I really admire this person on the field or what he's done. I don't know what he's like off the field, and I don't want to give him hero status without knowing the person that he is. I love the athlete that he is, but I don't know the person that he is.
Right. So speaking of the person that you are, let's get off of soccer a little bit, because I know you're more than just a soccer player.
Is he?
Yeah, I believe it or not.
I'm joking.
Well, I've been told, but one of the things that I've heard about you, that I know about you, is that you are an unashamed metalhead.
Oh, hell yeah.
You love some heavy metal, and I know True here is trying to up his heavy metal game.
Yes.
He's looking to get some new heavy metal. Grow his mullet out a little bit.
Just a little
nice.
Bit.
But what are you listening to right now? Like, I wouldn't even know what to go listen to these days as far as heavy metal.
I've been pretty fortunate because I think in particularly in Europe, as a soccer player, and I think you've probably seen it here too as well, that a lot of musicians want to be athletes and a lot of athletes want to be musicians.
Right.
Our boy Craig Terrell, where's he at? He's right here somewhere with a guitar, I think. But it's part of that genre. So I think what I realized is I kind of segued. I don't want to be a musician, but I just appreciate what's going on. I had a lot of friends in the music business. So they were able to introduce me to a lot of guys in Europe and as bands would come through. And so I have a lot of friends in the metal scene. So you want to come in and we'll get you...
Rock out.
We'll get you
bit.
Into like a Slipknot concert.
Okay. Or
you got to rock out. You got to do this thing right here with your fingers when
we'll,
you do it.
Yeah, we'll get right, you. Right. We'll get you in some deep stuff. You know, so
okay.
Some melt your face kind of metal. You know, so.
Nothing.
I don't
quite
know
like
if I want that.
Melt
my face.
Melt your chocolate face.
Yeah.
All right. Speaking of, one of the things I've noticed, Kasey, about soccer,
yes.
Soccer players in general. Are kind of flamboyant. They're a little bit different. Mm-hmm. They like to do wild stuff with their hair.
No, that's like Argentinians and stuff like that. But
whenever I see
all soccer players,
we're generalizing.
Where's DeAndre when you need him? But
whenever I look on TV, I see some wild hair flying around on the field. And so this is the barbershop. I figured we'd talk about it. Some of the wild, flamboyant hairstyles we see. So let's take a look at. This
Lexi,
guy here.
Yeah.
Lexi, you know him, right?
Yeah, he's a good old teammate, friend of mine.
What's going on here? Like, what the?
Well, there was a prime example of the athlete wanting to be a musician and wanting to be an athlete.
He got the rock star hair.
He looks like he wants to be a comedian.
Yeah, he actually.
Carrot Top?
Carrot Top. I would give him the Carrot Top.
He actually left playing soccer after the 94 World Cup and toured with Hootie and the Blowfish for a year and then realized that he needed to get back into
soccer.
Wasn't
quite the musician that he thought he was.
Yeah. No, I mean, he's a good musician, but it was just, it's a tough game. And when you're good at one thing and...
It's tough to be great at something else.
Correct.
He's great at the hairdo right here. There's another guy that has some wild hair. Local guy, Seattle guy, DeAndre Yedlin.
Yeah.
What's going on with the hair here?
It was funny. When he first came through as a rookie, he had this big mohawk.
Yes.
And I called my boy Marcus Hanneman, and they were down at preseason. I said, how have you not pinned him down and shaved his head as a rookie coming in like that? But it's a different time, I guess.
I guess it is. But look at this. True.
Frosty, man. That's crispy. I like that. I wish I could do that.
I told you. It looks
I
like...
might do that next. So next time I'm in the barbershop, y'all might see me looking like that.
What if I come through like that?
You know what? You did something similar, though. I think we caught T. Holla with one of his... hairstyles. I think we got one up there. We got one up there at T. Holla somewhere?
No, we got one, but this one.
Oh, that's clean. That's...
How did you come up with this hairstyle?
Stress.
That's when you got 120 million people watching you
make a mistake. Yeah, and you make a mistake, and then your hair just starts falling out. So it turns into that.
That's flamboyant. It's not as flamboyant as this one.
No, well, that's, yeah.
I like that one.
That's at the process when it started to fall out.
That's when you should have done the Frozen.
Yeah.
Let it go.
Yeah.
But it's still blowing in the wind, though. He still got a chance there. You still got a chance, right?
Not much. It wasn't long after that it started to get a lot tighter.
All right. Well, yeah, Kasey, you're not the only one we caught with some funny hairstyles. So we got one out there. What we got here, T? What do we got going on?
A pity fool.
I pity the fool. Couldn't find this picture. That's not a real picture, though. That's not my real hair, true.
Are you sure?
I'm 100%. You can see.
Well, it's in the picture, and you know everything you see on TV and on the internet is the truth, so I'll...
That's a lie.
I see a little bit of tape under there. I do see a smidgen of some glue or some tape under there. So.
That picture is a lie, but this picture is the truth.
Oh.
Oh.
Look at this. Casey, it's the lost member of Bone Thugs and the
Hey.
Truey Bone.
You couldn't tell me nothing there, because there it looks like that, but when you braid it back and have it all nice and silky, my hair was all the way down to my neck. And
that's the next Fridays, right?
The next Friday. That was killing them.
Last Friday, that's last Friday. Hey, listen, before we let you get out of here, there's one thing I have to do. I've been dreaming about this for a long time because I know True very well.
Mm-hmm.
He's a very competitive guy. And from everything I've seen about you, you're also a very competitive guy.
Okay.
And when we bring people into the barbershop, we like to have them in their element. So we brought a soccer ball.
All right.
Throw it at his face.
And we want to see who can juggle the soccer ball with their feet better.
Oh, Jesus.
True?
I've not touched a ball in years.
Or Kasey, it doesn't matter. We're going to put you on the spot.
I haven't touched a ball in years. Me either. I got it. Let's do it.
All right. So let's start off with True first. True, you want to do it first?
All right, I guess.
Okay, let's see how many consecutive kicks True can get.
All right, can I get a couple pointers or something? We'll start. All right, and I'm going to ask the beautiful people at the barbershop, you guys are going to count for me. I think I should be able to get at least two.
Well, we're going to see how many you can get in a row.
You got to start with the ball on the ground. You can't start with the ball in your hand.
We got to let True cheat a little.
Throw it up. Goalie, I'm a goalie, you guys.
Yeah.
All right, ready? That's what we ready?
One, two, three.
Three. Thank you.
Mr. Keller?
All right.
One, two, three, four, five, six. Oh! Terry, you all right?
Barbershop insurance doesn't cover that. We like to take it out to the fans and let them know. We got some. When we told everybody that we were going to have Kasey Keller on, the fans went crazy, and they hit us up on Twitter, and they had all kinds of questions for you. So let's shoot it out to Twitter and see what they had to say. David Vitutu wrote in and said, ask Keller, does he sometimes want to lace him back up and come out of retirement?
No, not at all. No, I mean, it was one of those things where I was very fortunate to be able to go out on my own terms. And I don't think many athletes are able to say, I'm going to play for 20 years. I'm going to pick the time in my hometown to finish off the right way. When you're still playing, it was funny because you got to go to the point where you're like, do you continue to play or do you quit while people are still asking you to play one more year? Or do you wait till they say, why are you still playing? and I felt, I was almost 41 and I thought, you know, there's not a lot of pro athletes at 41 and or 42. And so I just, or even at 41, I just thought, you know, I want to go out while I still feel I could play another year as opposed to, all right, this is a mess.
All right.
I kind of got ran out the NFL. That's how it worked out for me. My thing was I was trying to play one more year. I have two younger brothers who playing in the NFL, so I wanted all of us to be playing at the same time. So I went down to a team in Florida, and it just didn't work out the way I had planned. But I get that question all the time. True, you think you could still play? I see you still lifting weights. I see your arms are still looking nice. So, but I would never want to go back to the NFL. You know, I just do this so I look good in the suit and look good in the shirt, but I don't know. But to go out there and hit people and run around and do stuff like that, I would never be able to do that.
Yeah.
So let's see whatever else we got. We got a question from Mr. Bill Schwartz. What was the best and worst part of living in a German castle?
Wait a minute, you lived in a castle?
Talk to the peasants, talk to the people.
Talk to the peons.
Talk to the people.
big fingers and a small keyboard. I was hunting in South Dakota, and I was I said,
I don't like the way this is going already.
Well, I said, oh, it's fantastic. I'm having a great time hunting peasants. And I meant to say hunting pheasants.
Right.
So, and then somebody put in, well, he did used to live in a castle. So I didn't shoot peasants out of my castle.
Are you
but
sure?
it was cool. I mean, it was originally built by the Franks in 970. And it was a castle. I mean, it had a moat, it was pretty cool. The only tricky part was there was parts where when you don't own it yourself and you're renting and things go wrong and you can't necessarily fix things the way you want, and then that was a little bit frustrating.
How do you fix a castle? Like, who do you call? Like, is there a blacksmith somewhere?
Yeah. It was funny, there was a problem because in the area they had a furrier, and it was animal called a nutria, which is very similar to it's like a beaver with a rat tail, and there's a lot of water obviously around the moat and around the area, mm-hmm. and we would get these nutria, and I would have to call the Jägermeister. Now the Jägermeister is hunt master.
You start drinking?
Yeah.
You can find out you have rats. You start drinking.
Yeah, just, well, Jägermeister means hunt master.
Right.
So. And he would come and shoot the vermin for me. Oh. And so it was
bloody vermin.
He knew that I was, you know, kind of a farm boy hunter, and he was gonna give me a gun, but they have a lot more specific rules in Europe and licensing, and knowing that the castle was kind of a lot of people would come on bikes and take pictures, and and I was kind of famous in Germany, and they didn't really want me to be photographed shooting things.
Shooting the peasants.
Shooting the nutria outside the castle.
Yeah,
so.
And the peasants. That's, I've always wanted to say that. I'm big in Germany.
Yeah?
I'm like big in Skyway. We got one more question for Kasey, and it was from Jamie Sheriff. He writes in, Kasey, which current sounder would you least like to face in a PK situation?
Yeah, the funny thing about PKs is it's pretty much just luck. So, you dive in a certain way, you hope the ball hits you, or you hope it doesn't hit you. I mean, whichever way you want to look at it. But, you know, it really comes down to just who hits the ball the hardest.
And who is that? You know who that is? You watch them enough. You go with the team everywhere they go.
I know.
Who is it?
You know, I'm not quite sure who's necessarily smashes the ball the hardest right now. They're saying that Freddie Montero used to hit a nasty ball, which had a little bit of swerve to it. So, and that sometimes was the worst. I have a few fingers that bend in the wrong directions because of certain balls that come at you and then start to go a different way. So you go to make the save, and then the next thing you know, it moves a few inches and catches a little finger that kind of bends back the way it's not supposed to.
Right.
So it's, but in a PK, really, it's, I kind of explained to it that it's, there's no real big deal to it. There's a player that I played against, a Brazilian player, played at Real Madrid forever, named Roberto Carlos, who used to strike a nasty ball. And he hit a ball on me in Spain that probably was about 30 yards out, hits this free kick that probably never went higher or lower than 2 feet off the ground and just was waving like this. I saved it, but it wasn't fun trying to deal with that kind of stuff.
All right, well, we want to thank you for being here with us, Kasey. Join us here in the barbershop. Before we let you go, for sure, the last time, we were able to dig through the archives here.
Oh, yeah, we dug deep for this one.
In B47, and we found an old commercial that you did.
Uh-oh.
Now, most of the public hasn't had an opportunity to see this. And it's one of these commercials that lets you get into the mind
of the psyche.
The psyche.
20 years in the game, and you just really see what he's thinking about
during the game. Mm-hmm. Let's have a look at it.
It's been a long day, man. I cannot remember if I grabbed my drawers from the clean pile or dirty pile.
I really gotta go number two. I smell something.
Can this guy smell him? I'm not sure. Could he take a whiff? I'm not.
Kasey, you don't smell very good.
I think he can smell it all. Shh.
I'm going to kick it anyway.
All right, let's put on the face. Let's be focused.
I can't believe I pooped and put it in his bag.
Well, maybe I just act like nothing's wrong.
Geronimo!
Play good. Nobody will be able to tell.
I hope they don't know. I hope they don't know I put my poopy underwear in this bag. I bet they know.
Yeah, they starting to ride. Don't let it show. Right cheek, left cheek, right cheek, left cheek, right cheek.
Oh, you hold this poopy bag.
Maybe I'll just pray about it. Lord, please let nobody smell my underwear today. Clean pile, dirty pile.
The mind of Kasey Keller.
The mind of Kasey Keller. Again, we want to thank you for joining us here in the barbershop, and make sure you come back and visit us sometime soon.
Man. Anytime, my pleasure.
Kasey Keller, ladies and gentlemen.
Appreciate it, boss man.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right on, right on. What's another one in the books? Another one in the books. We'd like to thank B47 for having us here in the house tonight.
Of course. We'd like to thank Rezin Marketing, of course, for holding us down.
And Isaiah Trufant. He's your brother.
Yes, that beautiful intro music we heard. Yeah, that was my brother, Isaiah Trufant. So shout out to Isaiah.
Yeah. Yep. And most of all, most of all, we want to thank you guys for joining us here tonight. Thank you very much for joining us. And we also want to make sure you follow us on YouTube and on Twitter. And on Facebook.
Everything Barbershop 206.
Absolutely. And next week, we'll have a very special guest. We're not going to tell you who it is just yet.
Yeah, you won't want to miss us.
You don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss it.
Top secret.
Make sure you tune in to barbershop206.com to find out who that is. Thank you, guys, man. And have a good night.